Good morning, Gateway Rotary. How are we today? It's Wednesday. Are we psyched to be here or what?
Yeah.
It's going to be a great meeting that we've got started off for you. We're going to kick it off well with the salute to our flag. Matt, could you please lead us in that?
Fellow Rotarians, please join me in our Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And David, could you please lead us in the four-way test?
Would you please join me in the four-way test of the thing for thick, say, and
first,
is it the truth?
Second,
is it fair to all concerned?
Third,
will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned?
And fifth,
is it fun?
That was great. Usually we have all sorts of hiccups. We've got some experienced veterans on what to do and how to kick us off with the meeting well. So that was fantastic. Great start. First, I'd like to recognize, I don't have a list with any visiting Rotarians on it, so are there any visiting Rotarians that had not signed in? Great, we'll move right on to guests. Mike Leonard, you have a guest.
And a full mouth. With me today, Joe Wolf, Thurston County Auditors. Might be his final visiting day as he approaches that new membership.
Do we have any other guests? Yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to introduce our speaker, our state auditor, Pat McCarthy, and a member of her communication staff, Adam Wilson, and I have to say I'm proud to be their colleague, so welcome.
Welcome back. We're going to be hearing a lot more about that in our main presentation today. Any more guests? Okay. So I'm going to move right now to our Think Rotary. Again, this is, and I hope you're thinking about it as I talk and introduce it. This is a great opportunity for us to recognize folks that are doing great things in the community, and Rotarians specifically, highlighting businesses, and trying to really just give recognition so folks know who's doing what type of businesses are out there. So, any hands, any takers? Well, then I'm going to go, and I'm going to throw one out real quick. So I've enjoyed going for lunch. It's kind of not a direct Rotarian, but an indirect. I'm going to recognize John Tunheim since I see him sitting here in Freshie's Restaurant. They go over there and grab lunch a lot or try to get some food. So they do a great job on the west side. I know Marsha owns that, so just a shout out. They do a good job over there. Anybody else? Grace.
The city of Lacey, very, very awesome in being able to call them and getting some information on, in my industry, it's the sign permitting. So thanks to them. They're very cooperative and helpful.
All right, good shout out to the city of Lacey. Scott Spence, do I see you out there? No Scott Spence. Okay, weird, surprising. All right, anybody else? All right, we're going to move right on to our Rotary Foundation Minute. And a member of our Foundation Committee will now share more information about the Rotary International Foundation and the good we accomplish in the world through our collective support. And again, this is Rotary Foundation Month. So, Nate, it looks like you're going to be the one coming up. Let's hear it for Nate Peters.
Good morning. And so this is the last week of Rotary Foundation Month. Over the entire month, you've heard us talking about our foundation promotions we've been doing. And so we've been doing Give 100, Get 100, where you give $100 or more, you get $100 matching in points to increase the level of your gift to your next Paul Harris Fellowship. And then we're also doing Give $25 and Get a Candy Bar. And so we've also, every single week, been elevating or moving up people to the next Paul Harris level in order to recognize them for their involvement and participation in the club. And today, something different is actually someone who has made their gift to reach their next Paul Harris level. Paul Harris Fellowship is where people are giving $1,000 or more a year to the Rotary Foundation. And today I'd like to recognize Dr. Ray Moeller for his Paul Harris Plus 5.
Yeah.
Rotary.
And so the doctors, they go with each Paul Harris, it goes plus one, plus two for every 1,000 you're giving to the foundation. So plus five receives 5 sapphires on the Paul Harris one. And so it's pretty, pretty big. So thanks so much for your support.
Thank you very much.
That's great. That's fantastic. And again, thank you for all those that have been going online. You got the email last week from Nate. I thought it was a good email, and it got you to the links directly. In fact, I jumped on it. I was out on a flight. That's how easy it was to do it. As I left this meeting, I was flying out of SeaTac. I'm sitting in SeaTac grabbing a quick meal before my flight. I saw Nate's email, went to the links, and made a donation for $100 because I grabbed the candy bar ahead of time, and I said, well, that's not fair at all, concerned. I wanted a chocolate bar for my flight, so I said, I better make the donation for it. So real easy to do, folks. Look for that email. Please go to the link and please donate to a great foundation and all the great causes that we have. All right, well, it's my pleasure to introduce somebody very important here who's going to lead the program, and that's our great, fantastic vice president. Let's hear it for the only, the one and only, Amanda Bay.
She is the 11th Washington State Auditor and became the first woman elected to the position when she took office in 2017. Previously, Pat was twice elected Pierce County Executive. She was also the first woman to hold that role. Over more than 30 years of her public service career, Pat has served as Pierce County Auditor and Deputy Auditor and Board President for the Tacoma School District. Pat is dedicated to shining a brighter light on government operations for the public because she believes audits increase public trust in government. Please help me welcome Pat McCarthy.
Okay, as they say in the McCarthy house, top of the morning to you.
Yeah.
Especially in O'Blarney's, right?
Yeah.
I will tell you that I did serve in a Rotary for 10 years when I was a deputy auditor and county auditor in Pierce County. I love my Rotary. They knifed me into being president and with all that responsibility, and they said, oh, it's a piece of cake. Well, it wasn't. It was a lot of work, but it was great, and I still have great affection and friendship with many of my fellow Rotarians. I will tell you that it's really great to be here with Stephen, and you have Stephen as a part of your Rotary group, and he really is a diamond in the rough in the state auditor's office, to the degree that he is, I don't know if you know this, but he is a cultural anthropologist, so he really is value added for us in helping to expand our portfolio of the types of people that work in the state auditor's office, and he's been really doing a yeoman's job, quite frankly, in helping us with a cultural audit we're doing at Fish and Wildlife. So, anyway, Stephen, and then of course Adam Wilson is in our communications department, does a great job, deals with all of our communication issues, and I will tell you that when I first entered into the auditor's office, state auditor's office 3 years ago, we had no communication people. My predecessor had actually fired everyone. And so we slowly have built a small cadre of folks that have really turned the corner on how we can do the work that we do, which is not only to investigate, but to illuminate. We don't incarcerate, I say. We don't do enforcement. That is the hand of the Attorney General's office. So what we can do in the state auditor's office is investigate local and state government, but not do the next piece. And I think
I'm like
just a little bit. Okay, great. All right, let's see if I can manage this. Okay. So a little background on the state auditor's office. I will tell you that we have a great tradition in the state of Washington. You should be very proud of the state that you live in, because this office, separately elected individual in our state, was created in 1889. So we have a long tradition, traditional history of making sure that local and state government coffers are kept well and that they do what they are intended to do. So we have a long tradition. And our goal is to, of course, not only be transparent, but to be accountable, to be independent, and to be objective. So we don't work under the umbrella of the governor. We don't work under the umbrella of the state legislature. So as a separate elected, we can go out and do the good work, upholding government, local and state governments accountable. We're very unique, I would say, across the country in comparison to my colleagues, other state auditors in the United States, because we do what I like to say, soup to nuts. We do a whole host of audits, and we do it for both state government agencies and for local governments. So anybody that gets any taxpayer dollars, whether it's state, local, federal, we will audit them, and that is written into the Constitution. So you should be very proud of that. As I said, our vision is increased trust in government, because I tell our colleagues, which are local and state agency personnel, that nobody can tell their story. If you're in a local government and you're sitting here, nobody can tell your story better than the state auditor's office, because we are that outside, independent, objective set of eyes that comes in and looks at your books. And I think that is such a wonderful thing we can do, and we can provide to not only citizens like you, but to the people that are our clients, which are government. I will tell you that in my experience, we do more good in government than we don't. And we can tell those stories. We can tell the good news of what government does. Now, I will also tell you, we tell the good, the bad, and the ugly. So we have to do the full range, because that's our job. But really, we do more good in government than not. And that's something that a lot of people don't realize. Most of us, like our cities, our city council, and our school board members, and the like, the closer you are to your citizens, they like you to get to know you, and you would all know that. But quite frankly, the further away you get, then there becomes doubt and skepticism. So our job can be to illuminate, to help you understand what government's doing. I'm fortunate to have 425 staff that work in the state auditor's office. And you can see on this map up here, I hope, that we are sprinkled across the state of Washington. We have a number of teams. We call them teams, located in this I-5 corridor, but we have a number of them over in eastern Washington as well. Of that 425 staff, we have about 350 that are accountants. A number of them are CPAs, probably 40 CPAs, or we have a number of others that have other certifications. They come right out of the educational institutions. So all of them, from St. Martin's here down the street to Evergreen State College, we are getting all of those young people coming right out of the educational institutions. And really, this agency, in my experience of being involved in government for so many years, is a very nurturing, training-forward agency. Our job is to really get young people to understand government auditing, which is different than what a typical CPA would do, because everything, their work papers and everything, is open and available for public review. So we teach our young professionals about government accountability, and just like I did when I was county executive in Pierce County, I stole one of those fabulous people that worked for the state auditor's office and brought him to Pierce County, which he still is working in Pierce County, from the state auditor's office. We don't want to have that happen. We want to keep those people in the state auditor's office. But in a sense, I think it's good that we train these young people, and they come in and they really do are accountable and keep their agencies accountable. You may be interested. Sure, I'm advancing. You may be interested in how our audits are funded. Most audits are paid for by our auditees. And I will tell you, if you're sitting here and you're a part of city government or county government, you don't always like to pay your audit bills, but it is a billable rate system. So most of our funding comes out of that billable rate. For state agencies, the legislature gives an allocation, and then they pay for those audits for us to do those audits. We bill them by the hour, just as the private sector and accounting do. In fact, some of our governments do have private firms, actually, that conduct their audits, which we are then are required to review those. Our office's hourly rate is lower than any private firm, or most private firms, I should say, and our billing goes directly to supporting the auditor and our staff. You know, we're staff rich because that's what we do. I like to tell folks that this is a return on their investment. So if you're in local government or you do represent a state agency, this audit is really an investment in your integrity, quite frankly. So it's great value. So let's see. So the value is in a number of things: independence, transparency, accountability, public confidence, objectivity, and educational resources. I think many of you may not know that we have a non-audit side of our operation as well, and I'll talk about that in a minute, but that's something that really does provide a tremendous amount of value and resources for local and state agencies. So who do we audit? Just in 2018, this slide will show you that we did 2,721 audits. I don't think most people understand how much government is audited. It's audited all the time. Just ask anybody that works in government. Yeah, there are all the time. And we do a number of audits. We just don't do financial audits. We do what we call accountability audits. And those accountability audits, you can see in 2018, we did 1,300 of them. Those are the ones where we actually look at their minutes. We look at where our objective is really to look at for compliance. Are they following the Open Public Meetings Act? Are they following state laws? Are they following their own policies and procedures? So those are called accountability audits. We do financial audits. We do federal audits. We actually do the state's full audit for the state of Washington. We do whistleblowers. We have a fraud program. And we have other things that we do, attestations and the like. So we perform audits, as I've been saying, for all local governments in our state and all state agencies. And because the governments within Washington and the different types of audits we conduct, we release an average of over 200 audits a month. It's a lot of work. Covering every government in the state, we have 2,300 local governments. I mean, that's a lot of government. We have the general purpose, which are really the cities and the counties, but then we have all those special purpose, and probably the largest of those are school districts. We have 295 plus school districts in the state of Washington, but we have junior taxing districts, library districts, water districts, sewer districts, drainage districts, and the like. In fact, when I first started, they said, well, we also do mosquito districts. I said, we have mosquito districts too? Yes, and they enlightened me to say, well, you know, there is something called the West Nile virus, and that's the purpose of having a mosquito district, to be able to ensure that you keep those areas that have standing water are avoid any kind of viruses. Part of Washington's commitment to accountability is stressing local control, of course. Many government activities in our state are controlled by small governments with a specific purpose, like I said, special purpose district. These districts may support efforts such as education and providing energy, but all of them are public entities, and their funding and operations are accountable to the public, and we keep them accountable because that's our job, to be able to audit them, audit their books. So you hear that term a lot when you talk about the state auditor's office, about shining a bright light, and like I said, our main task is to investigate and illuminate, so we bring it out. We do rely on the media. I think we have in the past a lot. We're trying to actually do our own work and trying to do a better job of communication, so that you'll be maybe inclined to come to the state auditor's office and look at our website. So we really want to be able to shine the bright light of what's happening with government. I've only had one press conference. I'm not a big press conference person. but I've only had one, and that was to call attention to issues we uncovered that were that was regarding a small community city called Wapato in eastern Washington that had some tremendous, some very egregious errors. Everything from failing to follow state law and their own policies and procedures, the Open Public Meetings Act, nepotism, fraud, code of ethics for municipal officers, inappropriately transferring money from a restricted account to make improvements to the city swimming pool. So they did a whole host of things that were beyond the pale, really, in recent memory of most people that worked in the state auditor's office. And so it was really incumbent for me to be able to shine a brighter light and to be able to use the platform of doing a press conference to be able to let the public know. And you know, it's funny, when I did that press conference, we had a number of citizens that were there, and they said, you know, why can't, isn't somebody going to do something about this? I said, well, because there's fraud, we can hand our the issue, that particular, those particular issues to the Attorney General's office, and the Attorney General did take action there. But we also worked closely with the prosecutor there in Yakima County. But basically, I said, we believe in a representative form of government. If you don't like what your city council or your mayor or your city administrators are doing, you have the right, not the city administrator, the electeds, you have the right to unelect them. And that's exactly what the citizens did that following election cycle. So the system worked. The AGO, the Attorney General's office, did file a civil lawsuit, and the city administrator was out, and the prosecutor in Yakima County is proceeding to pursue some criminal action on some of the employees, or at least one of them. Like I said, we look at more than just financial audits. Our most frequent audits are accountability. I talked about those. We also want to ensure that public funds are accountable for and protected from misuse. So we do have an investigation team, fraud team that are embedded really across the state of Washington to look at potential fraud. But most fraud, I would say, I would submit that most fraud really occurs from an employee who sees something happening within their organization or their unit, and then they report that, and then it works up its way to us coming in and actually doing an investigation. We've had, unfortunately, some pretty significant fraud cases in the state of Washington, one in Spokane County, and one currently going on in Pierce County. So it's very disheartening to see that happen. One of the things that we do, you may not be aware, is we do cybersecurity audits. And so what's a cybersecurity audit? Well, if a city or a county or a state agency wants us to come in and do some white hat penetration testing to look at their systems and to know whether they have, they're vulnerable or they need some tighter internal controls with their technology, we will work with that local or state agency to be able to come up with a scope of work, and then we will do that body of work. Fortunately for local and state agencies, we can use a pool of money that the citizens, we the citizens, elected to pass I-900 back in 2005, which allows for a tranche of money for us to use. It generates about $40 million per biennium. We get about half of that, and we can use those monies to do these cybersecurity audits. So they don't have to pay for them per se, because we can use that tranche of money. And they're very popular. We have a 5-year waiting list on folks wanting us to come in and do these cybersecurity audits. We are all vulnerable. I like to say, we know your mother's maiden name. We know your social security number. We know your HIPAA records. We're government, because government has all your private information. But at the same time, government, in my opinion, is trying to lean in to provide that information not only to you as an individual citizen, that's your information, but also to the public at large. So I see government really trying to open up what they do, how they do what they do. So how do you find that sweet spot? And so it's incumbent on us to really, since we're doing these audits, to be able to provide information to those entities to let them know if they have some vulnerable areas. Now, this is the one and only thing that is not transparent in the state auditor's office, because we couldn't come and do a report to tell you, here, the public, here are all their vulnerable areas. So we do it in executive session so that they will know and make some reconciliations or make some remediations to what their vulnerabilities will be. And I will tell you, we've done, I think, 13 state agencies, and we've done, Adam, how many local, do you know offhand?
Seven this year alone.
So, like I said, we've got a waiting list that's 5 years back. Okay, I'm almost there, and then we can open it up for a few questions. Okay, now I did mention that we do things on the non-audit side of our house. Get behind them, wait. Yeah. We do some things on the non-audit side, so we provide resources and training to help governments help themselves. So we call it our Center for Government Innovation, and they improve, their goal and their mission is to help government improve their efficiencies and their effectiveness. The center trains governments in process improvement, also known as lean, and that's what Stephen is. He's a lean expert. So that they can become more streamlined and provide better, more efficient services to their customers and their citizens. The center also develops and distributes a variety of resources aimed at helping governments better understand the local requirements, responsibilities, manage, and to report their finances. Now, I will tell you, we've done a really, I think, phenomenal job, if I do say so, in updating our website. When I first came on board 3 years ago, I was hard-pressed to find information on our website. And if I couldn't find it as an elected state auditor, how are you possibly going to find that information as a citizen? So we worked with a company, contracted with a company out of Oregon, and we did a refresh of our website. First of all, we made it more modern. So before, you would see the Capitol on our front page of our website. But what we want people to do is to be able to navigate it, to be able to find information. So I implore you to go out and try and play on our website. We have a plethora of information, and I'm very impatient, so I like things that are user-friendly. I like the two clicks. I don't want to have to intuitively know that this is in that category, or this is what you need to understand to know the menu. It's very, very intuitive. So I think you will enjoy it. Most people that are out there looking at our website, most of it is government, because they want to see how they shape up. But we have some new tools that we've put on there that I think you will appreciate. Let me go to this one. You can explore the governments that serve you. So you can click on this. You can click on your county. You can put your address in, you can do a whole host of things to find a lot of information. You can find their audit reports, you can find their performance reports, you can search it to your heart's content. And I, in looking at how other states actually showcase their information, their public information of accountability, many of them had a map. So I wanted to ensure that we had a map as well. We have some tools on there called the FIT tool. It shows government's fitness, its fiscal sustainability. Those are really wonderful things for you to look at as citizens and be able to assess your governments that are serving you. So that really ends my prepared comments. I would open it up for questions, and if I can't answer, one of these two gentlemen may, or if not, we'll get it back to you and share it with you. So. Any questions for anyone? Anyone have any questions at all? Yes, ma'am.
So, as a parent with two kids in college and three more ready to head there, I'm curious what degree path that you are most interested in hiring. You mentioned a desire to get kids right out of college.
Yeah.
What does that course of study look like?
Most of them are the financial. You know, they could be an accounting, or they could be that. But if you look at Stephen, who's a cultural anthropologist, it could be a PhD. We have a lot of researchers. I didn't mention performance audits, and those are things that we do. We take a particular topic. We just completed one on childhood nutrition as vis-a-vis schools, and what can better improve diminish childhood obesity through those school-funded programs, nutrition programs. So, in essence, we did a performance audit. So we use people like that. The other group of people that we've hired are our cyber techs, and many of them were former military. They come right out of the military, and we snatch them up because they're so great at doing that body of work. So it's really a range, but most of the auditors who are doing the accounting work are coming out of those accounting, those financial institutions. Other questions? Yes?
Who audits the state auditors?
I love that question. When I was county auditor, I used to put my hands on my hips just like this. Well, who audits the state auditor's office? I used to say that all the time. That was when Brian Sontag was the state auditor. But I will tell you that we do, we go through peer review. So what they do is they bring a whole group of people. We just finished it. Every 3 years, we have a group of people coming out of the National Association of State Auditors and Comptrollers and Treasurers. They come and they audit us. So they are nitpicking and looking at everything we do to ensure that we're following all the standards, all the policies, all the rules, all state law, everything. And so we had a flying report, so we did extremely well, and I was really proud of that work. So yes, we are audited, but we are audited by what they call peer review. So these people come from all over the country. I will say that OFM, the Office of Financial Management, David Schumacher's group, they audit us as well. So we get audited as well.
One last question.
Yes, sir.
What is your process for establishing priorities for who to audit?
Well, people are on a schedule. So if you're a large county, like Thurston County, you're going to be audited every year. Financially, you're going to be audited every year. We do a cycle of audits for accountability. If you have problems, you've had a finding, which is the worst thing you could get from us, then we would come back and audit you more regularly until you could reconcile that. We do a risk assessment, but basically it's established there's a timeline of how we audit. If you're a small little special purpose district, you're audited every three years. So we audit you on a 3-year cycle. So we may audit your sewer district, may audit you, you know, this year, and then 2 years later we'll be auditing you again. Okay, thank you so much.
Right, what a great presentation that was. And as you all know, one of the great parts of our literacy program, this is short, one part of the literacy program that we love and love to recognize is that we donate a book signed by each of our speakers for Pleasant Glade Elementary School. And today's book we have is Nothing Stopped Sophie, the story of unshakable mathematician Sophie Germain. Yeah. And what a fitting way to talk numbers with our state auditor. Let's hear it again from Pat McCarthy. We're going to go right into announcements right now. I know we've got a few that are coming up today, and of course I closed my program. I know we've got Megan, Courtney, and Shannon that are going to be making announcements, so if you guys can make your way up here. And let's just kick it off with Shannon Glenn, who's going to have some stats about membership. So let's hear it for Shannon.
Statistics to the club about where we're at in terms of membership. Right now we sit at 69.98% male, and that doesn't make any sense. So we're 70% male. 13% of our club is 39 years old and younger. 6 members of our club have 16 plus years of service to Rotary. The longest serving member in our club has 34 years, and that's Dan Weiss. And then a little bit of a roast for our club. 15 members, 15 active members have never logged into Club Runner.
Whoa.
So just on a roast.
Who are they? Audit.
I love stats. That's a good one. So that was a great audit of our club, and we were able to take that on. So no, thank you, Shannon. I think that gives us some great information. All right, we're going to move right on to, I'm going to announce you guys together, and you guys can battle it out. Let's hear from Megan and Courtney with a couple announcements.
Good morning, everybody. I wanted to make an announcement about this Saturday's landscaping project at the Lacey Farm Stand. Everybody will get an email at about 1 o'clock today reminding you of all the details, but it's this Saturday, 9 a.m. to noon at Lacey Farm Stand off of Martin Way. And we'll be planting small plants and shrubs and laying mulch across the plants that we plant and having a good old time doing it. So please feel free to come by, hang out, even if just for a little bit. We'd love to get your help and doing all of that planting. It shouldn't take too long, but every little bit helps, right? So if you come out and it'll be a great time. Light snacks will be provided. If you have landscaping supplies like work gloves, shovels, box knives for cutting the landscape fabric, for mulching and things like that, you are highly encouraged to bring them. And the only other thing that I wanted to mention was the December social is on December 5th, and it's going to be a really cool social / service project, and I'm going to let Courtney talk about the mini service project that we're going to be doing at the social. Oh, and it's at River's Edge in Tumwater. December 5th from 4 to 7.
Isn't the farm stand located at the Lacey Food Bank?
No, off of Martin Way.
I know.
Lacey Farm Stand off of Martin Way.
Yeah.
It's like not the food bank, it's the Lacey Farm Stand. In my email, there'll be a Google map linking you directly to it.
I'm trying to link it to the food bank project.
Oh, yes, thank you.
Oh, okay.
I'm picking up what you're throwing down, Doug. So, the Lacey Farm Stand landscaping is project one of our overall Lacey Food Bank partnership. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, right.
Sorry.
Oh,
yes. So, before we can build any shelves and everything, we got to help them do their landscaping because they have to get their permanent occupancy permit, and this is the thing that they have to do before they can get that. So, this Saturday, come and hang out. Have a good time. Get your landscaping on. Okay. Social, December 5th, River's Edge and Tumwater, mini service project. Courtney Williams.
Yay, Courtney!
Yeah.
Take a minute.
What?
Take a
minute. Hi, everybody. So, as Megan mentioned, the service or the social committee and the service committee are merging. So, to ensure that efforts are spread across the board, we're partnering with Pleasant Glade Elementary School, and we're going to be doing two projects in one night. And so if you read your email, and if not, that's okay, please go back to the email because it gives us specifics. We're going to be focused on the canned food drive for them and then the giving tree. And so in the email, I said you're welcome to, if you can't attend the social, I myself can't, so Megan will be the point of contact. Bring if you want, sign up on the sign-up list, or you can bring money, you can bring supplies to wrap the gifts, you can also bring canned food items as well. And so we would love to, and some individuals already brought supplies, and they're on the back pool table. Megan will take them, so if you want to come to the next few meetings and bring that, if you can't come, that would be great. Thank you.
All right, those are great announcements. I got a couple more for you. In recognition again of this being Rotary Foundation Month, please keep on your schedules. My oldest daughter's birthday of March 19th, which is going to be the Paul Harris Dinner. Paul Harris Dinner will be at the Hotel RL, and early bird and new Rotarian pricing is available. So please go to paulharrisdinner.com and sign up. I have signed up, so I hope more of you sign up because I don't want a table with just me and Ken Balsley.
Yeah.
All right.
Nobody does.
Sorry, Ken.
Goodbye, Facebook.
Start thinking district conference, and please put this on your schedule. I said it last week, and I'm going to keep saying it. It is not a Mother's Day weekend, so we should have a great turnout from Gateway this year. It's going to be in beautiful Victoria, BC, on May 14th through the 16th. Really, it's going to be a great time. I think this is a fun event. Last year we had a small table, but we really had a good vocal group, and Gateway was certainly heard. I really want to bring down the house this year and make it so that they have to sit there and just keep pausing, going, sorry, Gateway, and thank you, Gateway, and just keep giving us that type of recognition. So please sign up, and we're going to keep that information coming forward on that. Lastly, I know we've got our event on Saturday. I'm really looking forward to that. To share, and I put an email out that the Olympia Club is doing the Cool Jazz Clean Water event. That's going to be over at the Washington Center on Saturday, and that starts in the morning, I believe, at 8 a.m. and goes to 6 p.m. So that's an event that if you want to attend and hear different jazz bands and supporting clean water efforts in Africa. With that, I'm going to call to the stage our great Grace Kendall, who's going to talk to us more about what's going on with classification talk. So let's hear it for Grace.
Good morning, everyone. We have a great, great team out there of members that I know are very, very, you have a lot of knowledge out there. And so I want to share that with the club today. So I'm going to ask you all a question. I'm going to give you some time to think about it while I do my part. And then I'm going to go out to you and ask you guys to share that information. And that question is, share with us some fun facts. We are a club, the fifth four-way test is what?
Fun.
That doesn't sound like fun.
Fun, yay!
All right, okay, so I'm going to go ahead and share one with you. And this is not just a fun fact, but I find it very useful. Question to you. Can you take a left turn on a one-way street?
Yes.
Okay, let me ask you this question. Wonder if it is on a on-ramp. Who said that?
The trooper.
There's nothing that's more frustrating, like, you guys know where my office is, so you're making the left turn to go on Lacey Boulevard to get to my place, and people are sitting there, and they do not know that they can take a left turn. There's no traffic coming, and they're just sitting there. Drives me crazy. And then I saw somebody taking a left turn onto an on-ramp, and I went, can you really do that? So I go and I ask my fellow Rotarian. And they say, yes, which completely surprised me. So now when I go up there, I make my left-hand turn, and people are just standing there, sitting back there, and they're probably wondering, what in the world is she doing? Well, that's what I was doing. So let me put it out there to you. Just in case you guys didn't have any, I brought some of my own fun facts. But I want to get the knowledge of all of you guys out there. So someone, tell me a fun fact. Martin.
Tom Carroll was the only Rotarian to burn down McDonald's.
That's
right.
Yeah.
Ooh! I think he's going to have to share that story. Okay, anyone else out there? And actually, we're going to let him come back, because we're going to, maybe not today, but we're going to have him explain that. Yes.
So Randy. Neil Diamond wrote the song Red, Red Wine.
Neil Diamond, I don't know how to sing, so I know this is not a singing club. Okay, anyone else? Do we got some fun facts out there? Come on, you guys. Yes.
There's actually a mental condition that people have that makes them blurt out things in public.
What?
It gets better than that. Grace.
Yes.
Fun fact, bald men are much more fun than men with hair.
Ladies, remember that, okay?
There's also a medical condition called confirmation bias.
What?
One of the Seahawks is from North Carolina, where Stacy's from. Right?
Awesome.
All right,
maybe one Seahawks. Okay, so I've got one here that I thought was about Washington State. Well, actually, I just gave the answer.
Go Cougs.
Okay, so the question is let me find it here real quick just to make sure that I get this here. Absolutely, 100%. The world's quietest room. Where would you find that at? Besides in Washington State, anybody know?
Well, the Lacey
yep.
Club.
No. Separately elected, Washington has more separately elected positions than any state in the country. By the time people got out here, they were pretty suspicious of governors appointing friends to all the things. So we have the largest number of separately elected in the country.
Wow. Okay, let me give you the answer to the question that I asked. I can see all of you guys out there. So the answer to the question is Microsoft has the quietest room in the world.
All right.
Just a couple of other real quick facts. The coldest temperature ever recorded was -144 degrees. 52% of the population is under 30 years old. The most popular language is Mandarin Chinese, and here's the last one I will finish with. How many questions do kids ask a day? Infinity. But here was the answer. Kids ask over 300 questions a day, and the hardest question that parents have to ask is, why is water wet?
Nice. All right, let's hear it for Grace. All right, as she makes her way up to the stage, I'm going to say goodbye to our folks at home. Thank you so much. It was great. Let's hear it for the folks online. Woohoo! See you guys later. All right.